What did you do with Marnie?
She's on the cutting room floor.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the cutting room floor. I'm your host, Dylan Cloud, and joining us once again today is the lovely and talented Deborah Voorhees. Of course, all of us horror freaks and fanatics know her as Tina from Friday the 13th Part 5, but now we know her as the director of the now-released film 13 Fanboys. Miss Voorhees, welcome back to the show.
Oh, thanks so much, Dylan, for having me back.
I want to start all this and just give you a big thank you and express my gratitude, because after you came on the show, when you were incredibly gracious and wonderful the first time, and we'll get to that first interview in a moment, but it added to me, at least, and for others, a level of legitimacy to my show, which has allowed me to do a number of other amazing things since then, such as having Vinny Guastafaro on the show. Just having you on as a Friday alumnus, you know, for others allows them to not just view me as some crazy fan on YouTube or whatever they think I may be doing. So from a professional and personal level, I just want to give you a giant thank you.
Oh, well, thank you, Dylan. I'm so glad.
I went back and looked at our first interview, and I checked the timestamp on it. The last time we spoke was September of 2019. Which doesn't sound like that long ago, but from all the things that have happened since then, it's been a lifetime.
Right.
How have you been through the whole pandemic? How has all of this affected you outside of the movie? Because, of course, it caused a million delays. How have you been dealing with this whole thing?
You know, for the most part, I feel like I have been really blessed. I live in an area that's kind of out away from everything. And so, so much of my life anyway is spent, you know, my favorite thing to do is to just go hiking. And that's a great thing to do when you live out away from everything and there's nobody around. So, you know, going and hiking and spending some time in the woods and stuff on my own. That to me is a lot of fun. I like to just sit in the woods and listen to the animals. So, you know, I did pretty well for the pandemic, but you know, it's been hard on everybody. You know, I have people I know, I've lost a couple friends. And many more friends have passed away and, you know, their family members and stuff from it and friends of theirs. And, you know, we have even our publicist right now for 13 Fanboy, is in the hospital with COVID and she's in her early, I don't know her exact age, but I'm going to say, I don't think she looks like she could be older than 28, 29 and in very good health, you know, very thin, very healthy. The one you say that's not going to be a problem. And the woman who's a friend of mine and also takes care of my dogs and keeps them trimmed up and stuff, you know, she has permanent lung damage from it. And, you know, we lost one of the members, one of the extras on our film set to COVID. So, you know, it's hit people probably more than they really realize. Sorry about that. I don't know where my camera is, apparently. I was adjusting the camera and I forgot it was on that side. So, to me, it's just really sad. And I'm hoping that we're all going to come out of this stronger. This is definitely something where we should have been working together on instead of arguing and being ugly to each other, which was disappointing. I thought when it first happened, I thought, well, if anything good can come out of it, then we'll at least be working together. But there was still a lot of that. But of course, there was a lot of the ugliness, too. So
from a professional standpoint, you know, I believe the last time we spoke, the original release date for 13 Fanboy was much earlier than now. And I'm sure you've had many delays due to, you know, social distancing with your crew and, you know, production delays and, you know, all kinds of, you know, media release delays and all kind of things. What was the original plan for 13 Fanboy as far as the release date?
We were really hoping to have it out in 2020, but, you know, I don't think it was necessarily bad for us to wait. The original date of would have been October 13th, which was a Friday the 13th, I believe, or was it in November? But it was a Friday the 13th. I do think we're much better off opening up in during Halloween, because Friday the 13th, we definitely have our Friday crew. We definitely have our horror fans. But I think opening up in the Halloween season gives us a chance to reach out to those people who love the Halloween, but maybe don't watch horror movies all year round, but they're going to catch one or two horror movies during the season because that's what we do, right?
Absolutely. So
I think overall for us personally, it was positive as far as the film goes.
Now, the film has an incredibly stacked all-star cast. You know, we have Vincente DeSante, Andrew Leedy, Kane Hodder, Tracy Savage, et cetera, et cetera. Of all of those, who were you the most excited when you heard that they had agreed to come on board? And who was the one person who you really wanted to be part of the movie but couldn't for one reason or another?
Right. Boy, that would be so hard for me to pick because all of them are so wonderful. But it was amazing to get Dee Wallace for our leading lady. You know, she's such a Hollywood icon and... you know, a horror screen queen, no doubt. And, you know, having her in the film is just pretty amazing. We did reach out to Adrienne King and she passed on it. It was mostly because she had a very serious situation with a horror fan or with a stalker. And it just made it it was too close to real life for her. And I totally understand that.
She and a lot of the Friday the 13th Part 2 crew were here in Atlanta a few months ago for a convention commemorating the 40th anniversary of the film. And she actually told that story about that particular situation she was dealing with. And a lot of the other cast members were incredibly shocked because they hadn't heard it before. Because I guess they had never dealt with such a situation. But I know for sure Daniel Harris has had a similar situation. And tons of other actors have had that same situation, which in a sense is flattering, but also in a sense is definitely overstepping boundaries. And I believe in Miss King's case, it even got very dangerous at some points. But it would have been great to have her in the movie.
Yeah, she hasn't told me very much about it. She said one day she'd tell me the story when she had some wine in her, because she said she really doesn't talk about it otherwise. So yeah, my understanding that it got to be pretty dangerous. The only thing I do know is that she tried to escape him and he followed her. And so she went to London, but he ended up following London. And then now in our cast members though, Laura Park Lincoln is in the film and she was stalked for 6.5 years. It was a very serious situation with her as well. And Judy Aronson had a stalker, not from the horror community, but from a TV show that she was doing with Aaron Spelling. And I'm not sure.
In some senses, it may be even a little therapeutic for some of the actors who have experienced those types of situations to, art imitating life in that sense, for them to be even more empowering to kind of deal that head on and then overcome that.
Right. I can see it being both ways, you know, choosing to stay away from it or choosing that, you know, they're both very valid points and just whatever's best for that individual is understandable.
Absolutely. Excuse me.
Mm-hmm.
Lost my train of thought.
Mm-hmm.
So you've spent many years, of course, you know, on the other side of the camera, on the acting side. How much, if any, of that prepared you for the directorial side of things, or was it just a completely new experience that you kind of just had to feel your way through?
Honestly, it really did help a lot. One of the most important things you do as a director is you're working with actors and understanding what it feels like to be on the other side of the camera. I think is very helpful to me. For one thing, I don't think I would be like this if I hadn't been on the other side. But when I'm first working with an actor on something, I don't do anything, which sounds okay. Well, that's kind of weird. Why not? You're the director. But okay, think of it this way. I've hired a cast member and they have a skill. They know what they're doing. I have respect for them. The first thing I need to do is see what they're bringing to the table. Now, if I don't feel that it's working, I will speak up and I'll say, okay, let's go this way. Or I'll say, okay, I like what you're doing there, but I want you to add a little more of this here or there. And the truth is if I tell them before the first time, now after the first time they show me what they're thinking, then I step in. If I tell them before that, they will adjust their performance based on what I have asked of them. And I might just miss out on something really amazing. And the truth is too, I picked some really amazing cast members and they were already professionals. They already know how to do their job. And so I think it's just a respectful way to start out.
Absolutely. You know, when you hire anyone to do a job, especially one where you've also been on that side of it and you can kind of relate to that, where you're getting direction before you've even shown. And I think some of the best incidents on film have just been from people being themselves, ad-libbing, thinking, well, I'm just going to go for it. You know, I watched an interview yesterday with Jamie Kennedy talking about how Wes Craven just kind of let him go for a lot of things and a lot of things that otherwise would not have been in so many other actors who really just through the combination of all the cast members and the director just giving them creative freedom,
right,
gave them something they couldn't even have imagined.
Right. And that's what it needs to be. And that, you know, you're right. You want to stop and listen to all the different people. And, you know, if it's not working for you, then of course you need to make changes and stuff. You know, of course now the things like anything to do with like cinematography or anything like that, you know, you're going to always sit down and talk with your cinematographer and discuss different ideas because they may have an idea that's great. And that'll work better. And I have zero problems changing my direction if I feel like we have a better option elsewhere. And then too, when you're indie filmmaking, very often you are really tight for time. And so very often you have to really think fast and on your feet of how am I going to get a really nice shot here? Because I don't have time to set up for what I would really like to have. What can we do in this time period?
And I really like the distinction you made, and we talked about this last time, how 13 Fanboy is an independent film, not a fan film. And I correct anybody I see who says it, because a fan film would be something, you know, based on something such as, you know, Never Hike Alone is a fan film. It's based on a character created by someone else, but still, and Vincente DeCente did a terrific job with it. 13 Fanboy exists sort of in the real world with the people in the film playing themselves.
Exactly. Yeah, the fan film is where you're literally pretending to be a Friday the 13th film or whatever it is that you're doing, if it's Halloween or whatever. But 13 Fanboy is completely different because it is about a fan with a deadly obsession for the actors.
So between you and all the other people, where did the majority of the screenplay come from? That come from you or a combination of you working with other people?
It was myself and my partner, writing partner and producing partner. His name's Joel Paul Reisig. He and I put together a 30-page, extremely detailed outline where I knew every scene and every twist and turn that we were going to be using in the film. And then after we had that outline, then I took it and ran with it from there. It was Joel Paul Reisig and myself.
with the final cut of the movie being done and premiering tomorrow, looking back on the entire process, was there anything that you wanted to get on film that for one reason or another you couldn't? And then was there something that ended up on film that exceeded your expectations wildly?
There were a few things, yes. There were some shots that I would have needed some equipment for that we just didn't have in the budget that I would have loved to have had. I would have loved to have had a very large crane that not only lifted up electronically, but one that also pushed in. I would have loved to have, and that would have been a really nice shot for opening. I would have really liked to have had some better lights for at nighttime. But, you know, hey, if this does really well, we'll be working on part two, and hopefully we'll have a little bigger budget and I get to have those things then.
And of course, there's going to be, you know, select theaters throughout the country showing the film and on certain platforms, which of course will be linked in the description of this video. Mm-hmm. But what are the biggest platforms as of right now that 13 Fanboy is going to be available to people to watch on?
A really good place to go and see all of it is 13fanboy.com. There's a button there that says now playing, and it'll have the VOD platforms as well as the theater locations on the VOD platforms. We have Vudu and iTunes, Amazon, Xbox. There's several pay-per-view groups. There's a group called In Demand, and they have like Charter, Cox, you know, really big ones. But then they have like 600 other really huge, you know, places, smaller ones all around that, you know, turn into something really huge. They have something like 90 million customers. I mean, it's something crazy. And there's several others as well. And then for theaters, I know I'm not going to remember them all, but I know that we have something in Lexington, Kentucky, Chicago, Minneapolis, Detroit, Los Angeles, Orange County, San Diego, San Francisco, Oklahoma City, New Orleans, and Sioux Falls, South Dakota, and several others as well.
How long is it anticipated that it will be in theaters?
I think it'll be there probably a week. We do have several people, though, that are starting in on the 29th, and so it's possible it could go longer. We're having what's called a day and date release. It was a really difficult choice for us to make because what that basically means is that we're opening up in theaters and on VOD all at the same time. Theaters, of course, for obvious reasons, prefer you not to do that. But now it's pretty much become a standard, or it's starting to become a standard. What are the reasons we decided for it is because in the company In Demand, they require you to be in the theaters if they're going to feature you. And for your film to really do well, it really does need to be featured on that type of platform. And with the number of their customers and everything, it made the most sense. Plus, another reason we really looked at it hard was because the Delta variant had just started when we were making the decision, or, you know, was just starting to really go strong here in the States. We didn't really know what was going to happen. And if most of the theater shut down, you know, we would be really hard pressed to hold on to all the theaters that we had put together, and we'd be very lucky to keep, you know, what we needed just to be you know, on In Demand, you know, in the highlighted area, you know, where the everybody has the recommended. That's what you want. You need the recommended area to really help push your film. And so it made the most sense to do. We were looking at having something more in the neighborhood of about 300 and something theaters around the nation versus, you know, I think we have like something like 30. So that's a big difference, but I think it makes the most sense. I think it was the smartest decision to do financially.
I would agree, especially with a, you know, a good portion of the population just not wanting to go out in theaters such as that. And I know for me, Halloween Kills this past week was the first time I've ever watched a movie premiere from home, which was kind of a new experience because, you know, there's just something you can't replicate about going to a theater with all your friends and seeing a big premiere, especially when it's a established franchise. But at the same time, we are moving into progressively more digital age. People don't want to be around. Sometimes, you know, if you don't go to one of the big like AMC or whatever, you may not be able to get to select your seats and be around someone noisy who might ruin the whole thing for you. And it's just a more controlled environment. So definitely I could see where you don't want to gamble everything you've put into this on the potential of no theater showing it, because then that would be catastrophic.
Right, exactly.
What is the biggest thing, you know, of course, no spoilers, but that you want fans to keep in mind when they go into this film and that you hope they take away from it when they conclude it?
Well, I think for years before the idea came about, the fans had been asking me what it is, you know, could I make something that included the actors from the series. Now, most of their ideas revolved around something that it would actually be a Friday the 13th film. So we would either have to gain the rights or do a fan film. And that wasn't something that I was really interested in doing. And of course, you're not going to get the rights right now because they're still up in the air of who owns the rights. So I liked the idea of creating something different. And this, I think, was a really perfect way to bring in some of the favorite cast members. So I guess what I really want them to know is that I made this for them. I listened, I heard them, and I hope they love it. And I hope that they enjoy it.
I know, again, without seeing, of course, I don't want to say high expectations because I don't like to set any expectations when I go into a film. I want to be as neutral as possible. But from interacting with you in our first talk and just in your Facebook group where you are incredibly gracious and interactive, I know just from how you are as a person that you have put your heart and soul into this and that it's a labor of love.
Absolutely. Oh, there's one other thing I want you and everybody to know. At the end of the movie, the music even stops and the credits are going by. It's quiet. You're dead certain everything's all over and you think you should leave the theater or turn off your TV. Don't. There's a little gem of a behind the scene comedic moment that happened that right there to me illustrates exactly how much fun we have on a film set and how silly we can be. And don't miss it. It's too much fun.
I think that's one of the greatest things that the last 15 years of Marvel movies have conditioned people to is you stay until the lights in the theater come back on and they're telling you to leave. Don't you potentially miss any Easter eggs, any post-credit scenes, because it may have been worth the price of admission alone.
Right? Isn't that the truth? I definitely wanted to make sure we had a little nugget at the end.
And of course, you know, when you're in charge of a production on the directorial side and you're kind of organizing this whole thing, you have a bit more responsibility attached to it, especially with all the finances involved. Did that get in the way of you having as much fun as you would on the other side as an actor where it's someone else's money you're worrying about? Did you have, you know, you and the cast have as many silly and fun interactions as you've had on the actorial side?
Well, it is true that since I was a co-producer as well as directing, that does put an awful lot of pressure on me. There were times where, you know, I just couldn't go and hang with people because I had 1,000 things to do. You know, at most people's days were about 12 hours. Mine were a lot longer. So it does take away a little bit of that, but I still get the time on the set. And, you know, I love every minute of it. And the truth is, I love being in charge. I do it naturally.
Does it take you back to your days as teacher?
I mean, pretty much that's kind of my thing is I like to be in charge. I'm not really much for following somebody else.
Outside of 13 Fanboy, do you plan to do any more directing, you know, other than any other sequels? Do you plan to make this Absolutely. A routine for you now?
Absolutely. You know, I've been doing directing for about 10 years. My first film was about 10 years ago. It was called Billy Shakespeare. And that basically was my film school. You know, just teaching myself. And I made a lot of mistakes. I got a lot of things right. And I learned a lot. And then I did a film called Catching Up, which is kind of like an arty, dark comedy, black and white, about a socialite who was obsessed with the idea of murder. Then I started doing several shorts, kind of, as well as a lot of music videos and stuff. And then I really felt like I was really ready to take on something more mainstream. Like one of the things I really would like to do next is a good ghost story. So one of the shorts I did was I picked something where I had a ghost, and it part of the reason I did it was because I wanted to play with the technical side of it, because I was going to need to put my ghost on a green screen, but have it look like she was interacting with everybody else and be able to cut it and make it look right. And I'm quite happy with the way it turned out. So I'm ready for my ghost story.
Of course, I wouldn't be doing my job if I didn't ask you, is there anything in the process? Of course, you know, every movie has their deleted scenes, but did anything end up on the cutting room floor is going to potentially end up on any home media releases?
You know, I don't plan on releasing another cut. But what we may be doing, if it's well received and it seems worth it to do a behind the scenes DVD, then we'll do that and we'll include some of the cut scenes in it.
And there is going to be a home media, you know, DVD, Blu-ray release of some variety.
There will be. I have not been given a date yet. That really is up to our distributors. They're working on it right now. Usually it's a couple months after the release of the film. So hopefully I'll know fairly soon when they'll actually be releasing DVDs.
And all these updates will continue to be available via 13fanboy.com.
Yes, I will keep them there. They can also find me at Deborah Voorhees Sheer Horror Group on Facebook, and I post everything there. I am pretty much always at about 5,000 on my personal page on Facebook, but you can still follow me because I have it open to the public. And then I have a page 13 Fanboy on there, on Facebook, and then on Twitter. Just starting to get a hang of Twitter. I'm starting to actually like it. It was really frustrating to me for a while, but I think I've finally gotten the hang of it. And so I have my personal one and 13 Fanboy on there. And anybody who will follow me on there, I'd appreciate it, because I'm just trying to build up and find people, everybody on that end of it. And then let's see. And then 13fanboy.com is a great place to look. I will definitely be keeping that updated on everything.
Amazing. You heard it right from the source, ladies and gentlemen. I want to thank you again, Ms. Voorhees, for giving me some of your time, again, professionally and as a fan of the movies. And everyone knows how much I love Friday the 13th, mm-hmm. Part 5. I consider myself the bastard child of the horror community, much as that movie is. But I like to think, much like the movie, I'm trying to develop a cult following of my own. So, again, it's been an incredible honor to speak with you, and I can't thank you enough for coming on. And until next time, ladies and gentlemen, for Miss Deborah Voorhees, I've been Dylan Cloud. We'll see you next time on the Cutting Room Floor.